today's video, we're going to look at waves, in particular progressive waves. And that means waves that are not stationary waves, just kind of those regular waves like sound and light. So we look at labeling, definitions, what polarization is, and also what phase difference is. So first thing is to draw out a wave and start to label it. Now it's going from left to right, so all points on the wave will oscillate up and down and the wave will travel left to right. Now if I've got my x-axis is time, that means the distance between one peak to another is known as the time period. Okay, and the time period can be defined as the time for one complete wave or one complete cycle. Knowing that, we can also use it to define the frequency. So the frequency of a wave is given by 1 divided by the time period. And frequency is the number of waves or number of cycles in 1 second. And we should know that is measured in hertz or seconds to the minus 1. Now we've got the equilibrium point to the maximum displacement, which is the amplitude. And that's how we define the amplitude. The amplitude is equal to the maximum displacement. So displacement meaning the distance in a straight line between the equilibrium point and where the particle is. So the maximum displacement is refers to the amplitude. Now, because it's a progressive wave, that means it moves. So in this case, we're moving left to right. So the particle that we see on the screen are going to be moving up and down depending on whether the wave has a peak coming up to them or a trough coming up to them. So all particles oscillate to the maximum displacement just at different times, which is not the same on a stationary wave, which you can see in my other video to find an explanation of that. So the wavelength, and we should know this from GCSE, is the shortest distance between two particles or two points on a wave that have the same displacement. Okay, so I can't label it on my graph here because I've got time on my x-axis, but if I did have distance or displacement, I was talking about a wave, I could label it there instead. Next, let's look at the wave speed equation. So the general equation for speed is equal to distance divided by time. Now we're going to talk about just one cycle and at the distance and the time taken for that one wave cycle to take place. So the distance of one cycle, as we just mentioned, is known as the, or one wave is known as the wavelength. So wavelength is going to be our distance. Now the time taken for one wave is going to be the time period, so capital T. Okay, so I've got time for one wave and distance. Now, instead of time, I can write down 1 over frequency because time period equals 1 over frequency. And if I divide by a denominator, that means I can put it on top. So speed, which you usually use the letter C for instead of V, is given by frequency times wavelength with the units given there on the screen. So that's our labeling and definitions done. Let's talk about something that happens with progressive waves, which is called polarization. Now, this polarization, this effect only happens with transverse waves. So we're going to talk about the difference between transverse and longitudinal first. So transverse waves means it has oscillations that cause the wave are perpendicular or right angles to the direction of energy transfer or to the direction of the propagation of the wave. For longitudinal, oscillations are parallel or in the same direction as the direction of energy transfer. So you do need to know some examples for each of these as well. So examples for transverse wave tend to be light and anything on the electromagnetic spectrum. Longitudinal, there's less of them example wise, but you've got sound, you've got ultrasound, you've got P waves for earthquakes and that kind of thing. Now the easiest demonstration of this you might have seen is on a slinky or something similar, where if you push it from left to right, the wave moves left to right. You have these compressions traveling down the wave, whereas if you're trying to demonstrate a transverse wave, if you move it up and down, the wave will still go left to right. This time it's at a right angle to the oscillations that caused it. Okay, now, as I mentioned earlier, we're only going to talk about transverse waves when we talk about polarization, and that's because transverse waves can be polarized, and they're the only type of waves that can be polarized. You cannot do it with longitudinal waves, and I'll explain why. Now, I've got a slightly tricky task to draw a diagram of this. I'm going to draw some unpolarized waves. Now, this is deliberately not going to be great. You can find a better image I'm going to put on the screen as well, but the idea is they're oscillating in all directions, so up, down, left, right, diagonally, etc. It's easier to demonstrate if you look head on. So if I look head on at the wave, I'd find they might have oscillations up and down, they might have some from left to right, and I might have some in diagonally as well. And even though I can't draw in the diagram, they are in all directions. Now this is what's known as an unpolarized transverse wave. Okay, so an example of that would be an electromagnetic wave. Now the definition would be that its vibrations or oscillations are in all planes, or it's vibrating or oscillating in all planes of directions, basically. So plane is the fancy word for direction if you weren't sure. Now let's look at what happens when I, or what we need to do to polarize these waves. So to polarize it means I'm going to limit the oscillations to one plane or one direction only, just like these blue ones here. So the definition would be vibrations or oscillations are in one plane only. Okay, so looking at it head on, I've just got the left to right ones here instead of up and down. That's also known as plane polarized. And this one would be horizontally polarized because I've let the horizontal plane through. Instead of the vertical one, I could do that as well. And that would be vertically polarized light or vertically polarized wave. Now, how do I go about achieving this? Well, it's due to something called a polarizing filter. So polarizing filter obviously doesn't look like this. You might have seen one in school. Generally, they look like dark pieces of kind of perspex. In this case, it's got it's designed just to let those vertical planes of wave through, or vertical oscillations through. Now, where might you use this? Why is this important? Well, this is the kind of technology that's used in Polaroid sunglasses, which reduces glare. And the glare means the light that's reflecting off bodies of water. So lakes or the sea, etc., which tend to be polarized. So if they're polarized in one direction, your polarized sunglasses let through the other direction, so they don't let through as much glare, and it reduces the light intensity in that case, and it reduces the overall intensity as well, not just the glare. You'd find them also in satellite dishes, which have to be aligned in the correct direction for radio waves to be transmitted and to be received successfully. Okay, so that's polarization. Let's have a little look at phase difference then, or phase in general, which comes up multiple times in A-level when we talk about waves. So let's draw a wave on the screen again. This time I've extended it a bit. I've got some notches so I can draw a second wave on. Now this second wave, you might notice, looks similar to the first wave, but it's kind of shifted to the right a little bit. Now what we say is those two waves are out of phase with each other, and we'll talk about what that means in a second. Now in terms of how far out they are out of each other's cycles, hopefully you guys can see it's a quarter of a cycle difference. Okay, so it's a quarter of a wave, then one starts. Now when we talk about phase difference, we need to compare waves to circles, and here's a really helpful GIF that can help explain it, or picture that helps explain it. So when we talk about phase difference, we're going to consider a wave to be one circle. So instead of saying a quarter of a cycle, we say a quarter of a circle in degrees, which is 90. If I was to draw another wave on, and we've got this wave compared to the blue one, it's going to be half a cycle out. It's exactly opposite, and it's 180 degrees out of phase with my original wave, which is half a circle, because that's half a wave. Now, instead of saying degrees, we can also talk about radians. Now, if you do A-level maths, you should know about radians already. Now, radians in a circle are 2 pi in total. So that means for 90 degrees, a quarter of 2 pi is half pi, or pi over 2, and half of 2 pi is pi radians. Okay. I've also got a little link up here to how to convert between them. So you times by 2 pi over 360, or to convert radians to degrees, you times by 360 divided by 2 pi.